The solutions that we described on how to virtualize memory and I/O clearly indicate that there is some degree of complexity and overheads that have to be incurred due to virtualization. Given the wide recognition that virtualization delivers important benefits, and as we pointed out earlier in this lesson, in that it presented an important path to address some of the issues related to rising operating costs in the IT industry, the hardware companies responded and they modified their architectures in a way that makes them more appropriate for virtualization. In the x86 world, these virtualization-friendly architectures started appearing around 2005 with AMD Pacifica and Intel's Vanderpool technology, or Intel VT for short. With respect to x86, one of the first things that was fixed was to close the holes with respect to those 17 non-virtualizable instructions so that they will cause a trap and pass control over in a privileged mode. Also, the new protection mode was introduced. So as opposed to having just one protection mode with four rings, now there are two protection modes, root and non-root, also referred to as host, because this is root is the mode in which the host operating system, the hypervisor, would run. And then non-root, that's also referred as guest, which is where the guest VM would run. Also, support was added for the processor, the hardware processor, to understand and to be able to interpret information that describes the state of the virtual processors called vCPUs. This information is captured in a VM control structure, or also called a VM control block in the AMD x86 architectures. The fact that the hypervisor understands how to interpret this data, so it can walk this data structure, is the term that's commonly used, means that you can specify whether or not a system call should trap. So it's easy for the hypervisor to know that a particular type of operation should not cause a trap into root mode and instead should just be handled by the privileged layer in the non-root mode. So the privileged layer in the non-root mode is the operating system. And other pieces of information that in a certain way can help reduce the virtualization overheads. The next step in terms of virtualization-related advances was to make it easier to manage memory. Since hardware was already able to understand the presence of different VMs, the next step here involved tagging the memory structures used by the hypervisor with the corresponding VM identifiers. So this led to support for extended page tables, where the page table entries now include information about the VM ID, and also tag TLBs. What this means is that if there is a context switch among VMs that's also called the world switch when we're switching from one VM to another, we don't have to flush or invalidate those entries that are in the TLB that belong to the previous VM. This is because the MMU, when it performs a check against the TLB entries, will try to match both the virtual address that's causing the access request as well as the VM identifier. And if they both match, then it will proceed with the address that's specified in the TLB entry. Otherwise, it will deal with the page fault failures. As a result, context switches are now much more efficient. Hardware was also extended to add better support for I/O virtualization, and this included modifications both to the processor and the chipset side, and also device and system interconnect capabilities that were introduced in order to support this. Some examples of these features include things like multi-queue capabilities on the device, and you can think of this as the device having multiple logical interfaces where each interface can be used by a separate VM, and also better support of interrupt routing so that when a device needs to deliver an interrupt to a specific VM, it actually interrupts the core where that VM is executing and not some other CPUs. Additional virtualization-related hardware features will also include it for stronger security guarantees that now can be made to the VMs, and also to protect VMs from one another as well as from the hypervisor, and also features for better management support or for more efficiently to be able to perform various management operations in virtualized environments. You can think of this as more virtualization-friendly management interfaces. Also, a number of new instructions were added to x86 in order to actually exercise all of these new features. For instance, a new instruction was introduced to transition from one mode to another, basically to transition to root mode or to return control to non-root mode, or new instructions to manipulate in certain ways the state that's in the per VM control data structure, etc.